everyone. Thank you for coming today. And I'd also want to thank the online attendees participating online and from home through the YAF virtual pass. One of the Young Americas Foundation's priorities is to inform people about the truth that free speech from conservative students is threatened regularly by the left. Students on high school and college campuses across America are being told their views cannot be heard or that they are unable to bring a right-wing speaker to their campus. Our next speaker, Spencer Brown, prioritizes vocalizing this truth daily. Spencer Brown serves as spokesman for the Young Americas Foundation. In this role, he makes sure that the voice of young conservatives all over America are being heard on their campus. Spencer Brown, a fellow Minnesotan, first became involved in the conservative movement in high school. He interned in the district office of Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann. After high school, Spencer Brown studied government and strategic communication at Regent University. In college, he continued his devotion to the conservative movement by founding a YAF chapter on campus. During his time at Regent University, he grew the chapter by overseeing YAF activism events, such as 9/11 Never Forget Project and Freedom Week. Through these events, he inspired other students to join the conservative movement. His involvement with YAF continued when he interned with the Foundation's National Journalism Center. Through this, he was placed at the Washington Examiner. However, his days at YAF didn't stop there. Spencer Brown joined the YAF headquarters team as digital director. He worked to expand the reach of YAF's conferences, campus lectures, and resources to students around the country. The following year, Spencer became spokesman for the Young Americas Foundation. In this current role, he has appeared on Fox Business, San Francisco Chronicle, and many more. I had the honor of getting to know Spencer the last few months, and I have to say he's one of the hardest workers I've met. He shows his commitment to the conservative movement daily by exposing the struggles conservative students face on their campus around the country. Please join me in welcoming him to the stage, Spencer Brown.
Thank you so much, Reagan. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. I feel like I've seen you guys a lot this morning already, so I hope you're not sick of me. As Reagan mentioned, I'm happy to welcome back our YAF virtual pass attendees, including my mom, who's watching from home. So hi, Mom. I always told her I would do that if I had the chance. So this morning's session is about what is conservatism. You know, it would be a shame if you all came here wanting to learn more about conservatism, talking about it, hearing from conservatives, and you didn't really know what that meant. I don't know how often you guys have been labeled as conservatives at your school, but it's usually not a positive thing. Has anybody ever been labeled a conservative sort of as a derogatory term? Yeah, it's not great, right? And how often do we turn on TV and we see, you know, people on CNN or Fox News debating what are conservatives, what do conservatives believe, what is conservatism? And again, normally it's in a negative light, and so that's why we think it's really, really important that you all know what it is to be a conservative, and more importantly, what it is to be a part of the conservative movement. Have you guys ever been sort of attacked for being part of the conservative movement or the vast right-wing conspiracy, as the left likes to call us? Yeah. So labels are something that are very important, but labels kind of come under attack. Does anybody have teachers who said, you know, we should avoid using labels on people, we don't want to label people because that's othering or whatever you may be? But here's the thing, labels are really, really important. You use them every day. So let's say, for example, I asked you what kind of music you like to listen to. Without using a label, tell me what your favorite music is. But that's a label.
Oh, geez. Upbeat? I don't know.
It's closer, but basically you're just reduced to talking about how you like banjo-y music or something like that, and even that might be considered a label. So labels are very important. What we see is conservatives sometimes are attacked for wearing conservatism or being a part of the conservative movement as a badge of pride. And something that I think you probably see a lot is people trying to assign the label of conservative to people who in fact are not really conservatives in an attempt to make you all look bad. As an example, there's a woman who is a blogger for the Washington Post back in D.C. Her name is Jennifer Rubin, and she is the conservative blogger at the Washington Post, but all she ever writes is hit pieces on conservatives. And so what she does is she gives the Washington Post the ability to say, oh, we support intellectual diversity by having a conservative blogger. But if you read any of her writing, you know, what we talked about this morning, the principles of conservatism, they don't line up. And so it's really important that you understand what it is to be a conservative, so that way you can call out people who aren't being conservative and also better expound on your principles. I think we're gonna go ahead and get started with group one. We're gonna talk a little bit more about what you all came up with as a way to talk about what we as conservatives believe. So who is the spokesperson for group one? Everybody, welcome him to the stage. I will give that to you. Where is your board?
Right here.
Okay. Conservative Padawans. So what did you, is that your group that you came up with that?
I didn't come up with that.
Okay. Personal responsibility, it's all good. So what are sort of the few things that you point out here in your group?
Basically a belief in the small, limited government, the free market, freedom of speech, fiscal responsibility, and in foreign policy, secure the border, peace through strength, and America first.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about peace through strength first. So does anybody know where that term came from, whose foreign policy that was? Yes, sir.
Ronald Reagan.
Correct. I was hoping y'all would know that one since we're at his ranch this weekend. So peace through strength, what does that mean? Wouldn't liberals or the left say that they believe in a strong national defense too?
So far,
but what's the difference between the leftist line on national defense or strong foreign policy versus what conservatives say?
Basically, what conservatives say, as for peace through strength, would be building up the military, building up our strength as a nation. So in the hope that we never have to use that strength.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And so that's sort of the difference in what President Reagan and what conservative foreign policy and national defense has been, is that we need to have the strongest military, the most able and prepared military, in the hope that we would never have to use it. And if you look at, I don't know, did any of y'all learn about the Cold War in your history classes? How many of your textbooks paint President Reagan as sort of a dangerous man, the way he pursued this peace through strength policy? Do they say that, he was sitting there kind of with his hand hovering over the nuclear button, ready to plunge us into nuclear winter and whatever else? That's just not the case. President Reagan knew that we needed a strong military, not so we could plunge the world into a nuclear winter, but we needed a strong military so that we could protect not only our interests, but the interests of freedom around the world. So that's a really key point there. What would you say when you talked about personal liberties and fiscal responsibility? How would fiscal responsibility fit into peace through strength? Because oftentimes the left will attack and say, well, conservatives are over here saying they want a limited government, but here they are spending all this money on military and spending money on this instead of on, say, welfare.
Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so the left will attack conservatives for trying to build up the military by spending money on it. What do you think the conservative answer to that would be?
That this money is going into building up our military, building up our defense, so that we as a nation hopefully never have to use our strength against other nations who try to undermine us or attack us, or basically our adversaries on the geopolitical stage.
Sounds good, yeah. And one point that's important to note is that President Reagan was very unique. As I said, your textbooks probably point out the fact that he was somehow a dangerous man or something like that. But he was the only person who said, we need to absolutely defeat communism. He wasn't there saying like, oh, we just need to match their strength. We need to be as strong as the Soviet Union. He believed that we needed to absolutely defeat the Soviet Union. And what did he do? He defeated the Soviet Union, even though his detractors often said it was impossible. His strategy was bad and dangerous for the United States.
I mean, he did call the Soviet Union the empire of evil.
That's true.
He did.
That's true, yeah. And that's something else, too, that we'll kind of get on throughout the session this morning. But the words you use and what you say when you're talking about conservatism are very important, because the left will try to put you in a box and make you use words that sound negative or that have negative connotations. But the way you talk about conservative ideas is very, very important, and we'll get to that a little bit more. But thank you very much. Okay, let's see. Group two over here. Who is y'all's spokesperson? Everybody, welcome them up. There you go, sir. Welcome. Step on over here.
Okay.
Okay, what did you guys come up with for what are the tenets of sort of conservative ideas?
The top three that we came up with were individualism, capitalism, and free speech. And we also touched on Christian values. Some of the big ones were, I guess it's more social, but the gun laws, and then also a pro-life agenda.
Let's talk about the number one point you have up on there, individualism. What would the opposite of that be?
I think it's identity politics. The left will constantly try to put people in a group, black versus white, straight versus gay, man versus woman. But that's not what America is. It's about an individual. everybody has something that's good for them, and it's different from the person to your left, whether they're a man or a woman, or, you know, straight or gay, or black or white. It's all about individuals and not about the group, which is what liberalism is about.
Right. The word we normally would use, I don't know if you all have heard of it, but collectivism would be basically the opposite mm-hmm. of individualism. And so as a way, you know, if this ever comes up in your class, as a really good way to describe this or put it into terms that your peers would understand would be to use your report cards or your grades. So say that you go to school every day and you work really, really hard, you do extra credit assignments, you always turn your homework in on time, and you have a 4.0. But then there's somebody who skips class some days, doesn't really turn anything in, doesn't study for their exams, and they're basically at a failing grade. How fair would it be, or how much would your peers like it if they took away one of your GPA points so that way you only had a 3.0 and gave it to the failing student so that way they would be able to pass the class? And that's sort of what collectivism is it's taking stuff from people who are working very hard and giving it to those who may not want to work hard or people who haven't worked to deserve it. And so if you know your peers are always saying, we need the collective because we have to all work together so we can all get ahead. But really what that does is it just brings everybody down. And also, if you're a 4.0 student and you know your points are going to get taken away anyway, why would you even work hard? You'd probably just kind of show up to class, sleep through class, and everything else. Let's talk a little bit more about capitalism. Why did you pick that word?
Well, I think it also stems from individualism, you know, the whole GPA redistribution. You know, everybody, you know, has the opportunity to be great or wealthy or respected, which is kind of what our group discussed. But not everybody chooses to take advantage of that. And what the left has done, it's, you know, and it's an attack on business. You know, big business is the enemy. And, you know, their answer to every problem within the economy is more regulation, more taxes, and, you know, less freedom, you know, economically. And that's just not the answer, because capitalism is the only ism that has ever made people rich, just like Dennis Prager said. And what our group kind of touched on was capitalism is the only way people can actually survive in an economy if you truly want people to be free and, you know, be wealthy and, you know, be successful. You know, yeah. Communism, socialism, it doesn't work because people don't have the opportunity to create wealth. They are only handed it, which it can't survive like that if wealth isn't being created.
Yeah, we'll come back to that point about socialism and communism in a second, but I mentioned earlier how words really matter when you're talking about conservative ideas and sharing these things with your peers or speaking up in class. And Young America's Foundation a few years ago did polling to see what students, you know, thought about words like capitalism. And we found that there's a very negative connotation attached to the word capitalism now, because people like Michael Moore and all these leftists in the media and everything else have made capitalism out to be this bad thing where you have the big bad corporations who are out there, you know, basically trying to just profit off of all of our work. But on the other hand, what had a very positive connotation among young people were things like free market and words like entrepreneurship, because that's something that's aspirational. Does anybody here want to start their own business? Couple people? Okay, yeah. So things like that. It's something that sounds very positive because it's you working to either, you know, start your own business or things like that. So that's a case where the words you use when you're talking to your peers can have a huge difference in how they initially respond to what you're saying. If you start talking about capitalism, they might think back to all the negative things they've heard. But if you talk about free markets and entrepreneurship, they might think, oh, I'd like to start a business one day. This is interesting. Let's see what they have to say. But then getting back to the point you made about socialism and communism and how it doesn't work, what would you say to a leftist who said, well, oh, they've just never been implemented fully, so we don't know. But if it was ever implemented, we would see that it's a superior system.
Well, I'd say that it has been implemented fully all around the world. I mean, the Soviet Union collapsed. You know, Nazi Germany, it allowed for, you know, the power of the government allowed for, you know, 6 million people to be killed. And, you know, in Venezuela went from the richest country to the poorest country. I mean, you can say that it hasn't been implemented. A capitalist society like the United States, you know, where wealth is created like nowhere else in the world and opportunity is, you know, radical, who's such an ideologue in, you know, favor of, you know, completely abolishing work, you have to stick to what works, and, you know, that is the free market.
That's true, yeah. Have any of you in your classes ever seriously? What was the context for that? Blaming the situation of the sort of thing you're going to come up against. So having these arguments in hand, so that way you can say, well, actually, it doesn't have anywhere it's implemented even partially, you know, the damage is definitely clear. And we can see that even in the United States with things, certain policies that the left will try to put in place, things like Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act. When you try to you see things getting out of hand very, very quickly. So thank you very much.
Nice talking with you.
Number three over here, who is the spokesperson for that group? Hello. Woo. Thank you, Alex. You can step over here. Okay, so what did group three come up with?
So what we started off with is we started off with your traditional fundamentalist constitutional values. So we took off from the Bill of Rights, going down from the first 10 amendments, especially hitting off of the Second Amendment, which protects all of those rights. And we also went a little into freedom of religion as well as speech, about how that also protects your values.
Okay. Let's start with Constitution, the fundamentalist Constitution, and the Bill of Rights specifically. So do our rights come from the Constitution? Do our rights come from the founders? Do the rights come from the government? Where do our rights come from?
I'd say our rights come from ourselves because we're the people who protect it. We make sure that our welfare is going to be intact because we have to defend ourselves using our rights, like speech and the right to assemble and...
So we're the ones who enjoy the rights, but where do the rights themselves come from? Where do we get those rights from? This is open to anyone if someone would like to shout it out. Yes, sir.
The rights are from the people. It's from the people because the Constitution starts off with we the people.
But we the people are forming a government in order to protect and have these rights, but where do the rights themselves come from? God, yes, and that is the key point. That's sort of one of the fundamental differences between how the left and how conservatives view things, because obviously if you have your rights coming from, say, the Founding Fathers or from a document or from the federal government, whoever puts those rights in place can take them away as well, and we've seen that just the way that the laws work. You know, people were told that health care was a fundamental right, so they were given free health care, and then because that was actually not a fundamental human right and that was taken away by conservative leadership, now that right is not there anymore. So the really key point is that our rights come from God, which means no government and no man can take them away from us. But as you pointed out, the people are the ones who enjoy those rights. And as you pointed out, we all form together in a government in order to have a way to protect our God-given rights. So that's really key. And that's basically the Bill of Rights, you know, things like the freedom to speak and assemble and speak your mind, freedom to protect yourself, things like that. What other items would you link up into the Constitution? Do you think there's any root for, you know, being pro-life or having individual liberty that come from the Bill of Rights?
Yeah, so we connected that into the limited government as per free markets, which we talked to Alex about, which is a pretty word for capitalism, and as well as individual liberty and being pro-life, about how that can be connected to limited government, because the free markets, the government is not being introduced into it, and rather than the government, it's us, we the people for the people, just connecting to our Constitution.
So what would you say, let's say, so on the pro-life issue specifically, liberals will say, well, you conservatives claim to be for small government, but now you want the government to tell women what they can do with their bodies. So clearly you're just being a hypocrite. How would you respond to that?
That is not a hypocritical situation, because in a pro-life situation, that is an individual liberty that you are going to choose, that you're going to, you know, in a sense, celebrate that life, because you're giving a voice to that child, that unborn child, whatever the case may be, that you're going to stand up for them because they don't have a voice yet.
And if you look at a really good way to push back on that idea is to look at what are the three things that our founders kind of enshrined for us. What's the first one? Life, and then?
Liberty.
And then?
Christopher.
Exactly. So it's not to be a big government person. It's not to support government intervention in our lives to say that we support the fundamental right to life of every human. It's basically the limiting of government in the most basic way, because it's preventing the government from condoning, you know, the mass murder. Since Roe v. Wade, more than 50 million babies have been aborted And obviously that is unacceptable to us. When it comes to freedom of religion and speech, what does freedom of religion mean to you and your group?
Freedom of religion means the right to choose how you feel about your interpretation of God or not, whether you choose to believe in him or not. Whether you believe in purple elephants, it's up to you, because it is your right to choose. You know, you don't have to have the government tell you. You don't have to have other people push something on you.
So one of the problems with the way the left reads the Constitution yet again is they see the freedom of religion as the freedom to worship, is the term that they'll use a lot. And what they mean when they say you, of course, have the freedom to worship, is they mean you have the right to 1 hour once a week go to your church or your synagogue and practice your religion, but then as soon as you walk out of the doors of the church, you have to just go along with whatever sort of the cultural norms are, the undercurrent would be. And that's obviously not what the founders intended. They guaranteed the free exercise of religion, which you don't just exercise 1 hour a week, hopefully. You know, it's the way you live your life, it's how you treat people, it's how you operate at your business. They guaranteed or wanted to protect the right for you to practice your religion everywhere, not just in the four walls of your church, but in your culture, in your society. And that's something that the left often just kind of runs over and hopes that nobody will notice that that's what they mean when they say the freedom to worship, but obviously is different than what we would believe. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, group four. If I can have the spokesperson for group four hop up here. Welcome. Okay, what did your group come up with?
We came up with a lot of things, but I would like to focus on small government, pro-constitution, because like what the other people who came up said before us, it's where we get our rights and where we can protect them, and pro-family.
Sounds good. Let's focus on the pro-constitution thing a little bit again. Have y'all in your classes ever had a teacher try to demean the Constitution or the founders because, well, it's an old document, or the people who wrote it were all white men, slaveholders, things like that? Have y'all heard that? Does that come from your teachers, your textbooks, peers, pretty much everything? Right. That is a false criticism for them to make, and there's a few really good ways to explain that to your peers. So who here would say that the Ten Commandments are pretty good rules, right? And how old is that? 4,000 some odd years. And just because it's 4,000 years old doesn't mean that murder is any less wrong now than it was when the Ten Commandments were given down. It doesn't mean that those ideas are somehow wrong or outdated just because they're old. And if you look at, you know, the things in the Constitution, they're not wrong just because it is an old document. And then the other criticism you'll get that is more frequent, I think, now is that because the Constitution, the founders, were all old white men who majority did not own slaves, but some of them did. They say that that makes it basically a moot document, it's a biased document, we shouldn't have to follow it because it's completely outdated and from a different era, and the way people thought back then was vastly different. But here's the thing, people in future cultures are gonna judge our society by the way we're living right now. And so when you look at things like abortion, where 50 million Americans have been murdered, obviously future cultures will hopefully look back on this and say, hey, that was a disgrace, and hopefully, you know, it's our generation that puts a stop to it, so that way in the future they can look back and say that was a bad time then and it's not happening now. But just because there are bad things happening at a certain point in a society does not mean that the people within that society are incapable of good thinking. So if you look through history, you know, you have other sort of documents of self-government. You have things like the Magna Carta and other sort of the roots of the Constitution today. Those are all brought up in old times such as those. But that doesn't mean that those ideas were bad, because obviously we've seen the Constitution has incredible staying power and has managed to govern the United States for, you know, hundreds of years. So that's a good argument against that one. What would you say if somebody told you that the Constitution should not be followed today because it's irrelevant? What sort of facts would you use to back up the fact that it's effectively governed the country since then?
Well, we're the longest standing republic ever in the world. As of today.
Yeah.
I think people are allowed to be free here, follow their dreams. Opportunity is vast. And there are a lot of countries who want to be like us. So if it was irrelevant, why do you have all these countries, like people in countries trying to fight for their rights? If it was irrelevant, then we wouldn't be the biggest and strongest nation in the world.
Yeah, are you guys familiar with something called the American Dream? It's not called the American Dream because nobody wants to be here because it's somehow like a horrible country with a flawed system of government. People want to come here because it has the most opportunity, the most freedom, the most access for people to better themselves, seek out a new life, and things like that. And so just sort of emphasizing the fact that the United States is more or less, have you guys been yelled at for saying that America is the greatest nation? Is that something you're not allowed to say generally? That's crazy. What happened? Have you ever been punished for that in a classroom? Yes? What was the punishment? Your teacher said it was unconstitutional for you to say America was a great nation. Have you given her a pocket constitution or him? Yeah, that is amazing. You know, sometimes that works. You know, if a professor or a teacher is giving you grief and incorrectly interpreting the Constitution, just give it a pocket constitution. We have plenty we would be happy to share with you. But that's insane. That's the sort of stuff that happens on high school and college campuses. There was at Penn State where Jolie went. I think she was even a part of this. She was trying to hand out copies of the Constitution in a free speech zone, and she was kicked out because apparently that was not allowed. And so these are the kind of things you run into. So being able to talk about the Constitution eloquently, know what you're talking about, is very important. What other main items did you want to pull out?
Pro-family.
Okay, yeah, talk a little bit about that.
Like what Sabrina said in our group, and I thought it was really good, without the family, and Dennis Prager kind of touched on this yesterday, without the family, people wouldn't care about military because you want to protect your family, and religion because that is what your family believes in, and free market so your family can create opportunities for themselves, and a small government because you don't want the government interfering with your family. Like, you want to, like, family is kind of like the backbone of society. It's what drives people to do things.
Yeah, that's interesting. So when you talk about the family being the backbone, what would you say is the critique the left gives again is that, oh, the nuclear family is an outdated concept that was perpetrated by the patriarchy in order to keep, you know, women from succeeding on their own. How would you respond to that?
There are many women who have succeeded on their own. Like, if families kept, like, women, like Hillary Clinton, she ran for president and she was a woman, and
and she had a family. She had built.
Yeah,
family.
She had a family. Kind of a family. but I don't think family keeps you restrained. Maybe in other countries, yes, where women don't have a lot of freedom, and that's why we're so lucky to be here. But in this country, families are what motivate you. I mean, I swim and I do water polo, and if my family wasn't there to motivate me to earn good grades and keep going to practice, then I don't know where I'd be.
Yeah. Well, and that's something that the left will try to use a lot. Will be, again, the left loves to divide more than anything else. So they put everybody in a group. So they'll say, you're a woman. You know, because you're a woman in America, you don't have the same opportunity as men. You'll never make as much as they do. You have to work twice as hard, and you'll maybe get half as far. But it's really important to point out the other societies in the world that don't have the same freedoms in order to show how well the American system of government works and how the Bill of Rights and the Constitution protects women. If you look around the world, you know, Saudi Arabia just finally this year started allowing women to drive, which is insane. And so you don't see the left out there yelling about how Saudi Arabia is evil in this horrible place. Instead, they're talking about why, you know, conservative policymakers somehow are trying to keep women down and from succeeding. But really, if you look at the way the economy has been going lately, especially, you know, America is the greatest place to be anyone, no matter what label you or the left puts on you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, we're down to the last group, group five. Do y'all have a spokesperson? Give them a round of applause. Welcome.
Thank you.
So your group, what did you all come up with as key tenets of conservatism?
So our three main tenets of conservatism are patriotism, original interpretation of the Bill of Rights, and freedom of opportunity.
When you talk about the interpretation, how does the left view the Constitution and the Bill of Rights?
Well, I think they try and put it in a more current form. They try and make it an entire perversion of what they want to put out there, when instead they should be seeing it from the eyes of the founders. For example, the whole Second Amendment issue, they always like to say, oh, they did it for muskets. Well, how dumb do you think the founding fathers were that they wouldn't think of technological advances? Or freedom of speech doesn't actually apply to genders or that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's very interesting how the left will stretch it. And so they basically view the Constitution as this flexible, living, breathing, growing document that should be adapted and interpreted by each generation based on what the society has at that point. And obviously that's not the intention and not the brilliance of the Constitution. The Constitution says that you have the right to keep and bear arms because they meant you have the right to protect yourself from the government no matter what the situation is. If they had been specific, obviously that would have been a problem if they had just said you have the right to own a musket, but that's not what they did because they actually had incredible forethought to know that the country would progress and grow and continue on like that, so that's good. Let's talk a little bit about, you put faith in country.
Yes.
What does that mean to you guys?
To us, faith in country meant more of never viewing your country, or not never, but always viewing your country in a way that it can be better. A lot of times you'll hear leftists say that America is one of the most evil countries in the world or that we've done terrible things, and maybe we have, but we always have that opportunity to rise and be better, and they just like to focus on the past and the terrible things.
Yeah, that's a good point. And if you look, as we were talking about earlier with the Constitution and people saying that it was written by white men slaveholders and so we shouldn't take it seriously anymore, if you look at the foundations that they laid, not only through the Constitution but through the Bill of Rights and the Declaration of Independence and things like that, their intention was for slavery to be a thing of the past in the United States. And obviously it took longer than it should have, but they put that in there so that way they wanted all men to be free, everyone to be free in the country. So that's another important point to make. And then you have patriotism, love for your country, which kind of goes with faith in country. Freedom to pursue happiness. How do what conservatives believe differ from what the left believes when it comes to pursuing happiness?
I'd say a lot of liberals try and put a specific rule set on trying to pursue happiness. So you have to stay within the binds of, not getting your full potential by giving it to others, for example. Like, I know that sounds terrible, but trying to mandate that you have to give to others, it's communism, socialism, doesn't work, and you should be free to pursue happiness in whichever way you would like.
Yeah, and I think one thing the left just kind of ignores is they read it as that you have rights to life, liberty, and happiness. They get rid of that word pursuit there, which is sort of the key word, because the United States and the conservative answer is that we're guaranteed equality of opportunity, but we're not guaranteed equality of outcome. And that's what the left will always say, is we need everybody to have a job, we need everybody to have, now the new thing is to have a living wage, whatever that means. They constantly are telling you that if you don't have everything that your neighbor has, that you have somehow been victimized by, pick it from the menu, by the patriarchy, by anything that may be. And so that's a really key point, is that you don't necessarily have the right to a perfect life and to everything that you want, but you do have the right to pursue that. And that goes back into what I was talking about earlier with the American dream. People come here because it's a place of opportunity. They don't come here because they know as soon as they get here, they're going to instantly have a six-figure salary, they're going to have a huge mansion, they're going to have three cars and everything else. They come here because they know they can start working towards that or whatever their dream may be. When you talk about smaller government, what does that mean to you?
Well, if you try to make a system that overbears on everything, it will collapse. And we saw that with the Soviet Union, for example. They had a 7-year waiting period on cars. And in capitalist America, or free market America, whatever you wish to call it, you can just go out and buy a car. I'm sure there's insurance and all that sort of stuff. But it's dictated on what you have and not who you are.
Interestingly enough, I saw the other day an ad where you can now buy a car on your iPhone and it will show up in your driveway. Just to show you how great free market capitalism is. Not only can you get a car whenever you want one, you can buy it on your phone, I guess, without even seeing it, and it'll just show up in your driveway in a few days. That is the beauty of capitalism and the free market right there. So when we talk about smaller government, a lot of times, excuse me, the left will talk about, why are you trying to basically make it unfair for everyone else, because they think that you need the government there to ensure that everything is fair and everything is equal, as we talked about earlier with the pursuit of happiness versus guaranteed outcomes. And so the left will say, oh, why are you trying to get rid of smaller government? Why do you think that the federal government shouldn't be there? Don't you want the government on your side? And obviously the government on your side when it comes to protecting your God-given rights is a good thing, but when it comes to determining what sort of drink straws you can use, that would be a vast overreach on what the Constitution or what the government should actually be doing. So one thing, I don't know if I saw it on any of the boards this time, but normally states' rights comes up on these boards somehow. But conservatives, we prefer the term federalism. So basically, as much as you can, take power away from federal government and keep it at the most local level possible. And this sort of feeds into how President Reagan talked about why tax cuts were so important. So we're actually coming up on the anniversary of the 1981 Economic Recovery Tax Act, which is the largest tax cut in U.S. history, and really unleashed the economy, jump-started a new generation of growth and business opportunity. But the way President Reagan would describe it is he would talk about how sort of two principles that lead to the reason why low taxes are good. And the first one was that the people whose money you're taking should have a say in how that money is spent. So the government shouldn't just take, you know, 20% of your income and then spend it on, I don't know, studying seal behavior in the Arctic or something like that. You should have a voice in how your money is being spent when the government's taking it. And then the other part is that the individual knows best how to spend their money. The government does not. So if you think about it, if you have $100 and you're thinking, okay, I want to use this to better my community, you're going to have a pretty good idea of what charities you like, who's doing the most good in your community, and the money that you give is going to have the best and the most impact on that. Whereas if the government takes that money from you and they put it into the slush fund and they use it to fund, again, seal research somewhere, that's not obviously going to benefit your community. So President Reagan's belief was that the person should have a voice in where their money is spent, and they know best where it should go. Therefore, taxes should be lower because I as an individual, will be better able to benefit the community and the welfare of where I live. And so when we talk about smaller government, it's sort of the same thing. You know best how to spend your money, how to buy your health insurance, what sort of car you want to drive, what you want to use to drink your Starbucks, whether it's a straw that they claim is killing everyone. Apparently that's the new plague that's going to hit us, is the straws. But it's always best to have it as local as a decision as possible, because you know best and the people in your community know best. So that's why we say federalism and not necessarily just states' rights. Is there anything, you put tolerance on here, what does that mean? Because the left loves tolerance, right?
Right. We sort of took it more as ideological tolerance. With a lot of the left, you'll see that if they see it's a Democrat bill, they'll pass it. But with the right, you'll see confounding ideas. They try and make it the best bill that they can work for as many people as possible. And that's what we kind of meant as tolerance to different ideas within your party.
Yeah, does anybody here actually believe that the left is tolerant like they say they are? No, it's not. And I don't know if you see it on your high school campuses as much as I see it on college campuses, but the left is the most intolerant bunch of people you'll ever come across, because they are out there and they say what they want to say, but if you dare to breathe a little bit in disagreement with them, all of a sudden they call you fascist, they call you hateful, they try to put you in all these horrible groups and labels, try to, you know, make conservatism out to be a bad thing when really you're just trying to share your ideas. An interesting thing about tolerance is that the left has turned it into a one-way street, especially on college campuses. And so you guys, as high school students, already face it a little bit now, but when you get to college, you'll see, I think, a different level even of how bad it can get. So that's another example of how the left has taken a word like tolerance that sounds super happy, fluffy, and they've just turned it into a way for them to claim that they're tolerant while at the same time completely shutting down all of your constitutional Bill of Rights. Is there anything else you want to hit on?
I think that's about it.
Awesome. Thank you. Okay, I hope that some of that was helpful to you guys. Do you guys often have conversations in your classroom about conservatism, or do you never even bring it up? Does it not get brought up? 50-50? Okay, well, like I said before, it's really important for you guys to know what conservatism is. That way, when you're attacked for being a conservative, you know how to defend it, you know your ideas. And just to sort of recap everything that we talked about, you know, we as conservatives believe in limited government, we believe in self-government, we believe in the Bill of Rights, we believe in the importance of faith and family, we believe in a strong national defense, federalism with as much local control as possible, the right to life, and the freedoms and principles of our founders. And all these things that we came up with today and all these things that we've talked about make me really proud to be a conservative, and I hope they make you all proud to be conservatives as well. And one thing I want to stress before we break is how much power you guys have. I know when you're going around your schools, you know, it can look like the people in think tanks coming up with new policies or ideas, the policymakers in Washington or your state capitals, potentially the talking heads on Fox News and things like that. They don't have the power. It's you guys who have the power. And if you look at polling on young people and everything else, your age group right now is when people are making their ideas and formulating their ideologies for the rest of their lives. And so you guys taking a stand in your classrooms and boldly standing up for conservatism and these ideas is incredibly important. As an example that we use a lot, Jolie, when she came to her first conference, was a communist. But because she was of a young age and had an open mind at the time, she came away being the conference director for Young America's Foundation and now helps expose thousands of students every year to the same ideas that literally changed her life. And so you guys, when you have a voice in your classrooms and at your schools and in your communities, can have a massive impact. And President Reagan, as we often point out here, said that freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction, which means that it's you guys, you're all that's standing between the freedom we have now and whatever the left may have in this messed up utopia that they want to build. And so we just want to make sure that our conservative principles are passed on, and we're counting on all of you to do that. Does anyone have any questions about what we talked about this morning? Yes, sir.
Can you explain
federalism? Federalism, yes. So that is the idea that the power should not reside solely within the federal government. So it means cutting it back, pushing it down to the state level. And we obviously prefer to have it as local as possible. So you want to have, like I said, the individuals and the smaller units are best able to make decisions for their community. If you think about the federal government, you've got 535 members of Congress and senators who are making decisions for the rest of the country. And so those senators and those members of Congress don't know necessarily what's going on in, what is your hometown? So they don't know exactly what's going on in Costa Mesa, but your city council, your mayor, your state legislature, they know what's going on there. And so they're going to be better able to determine what you need and what's the best use of the money rather than some bureaucrat, you know, 3,000 miles away in Washington. Yes. Yeah, so I'm guessing this comes up in y'all's classrooms a lot, given the debate as it is right now. But basically, part of us believing in the Constitution and the Bill of Rights is that we believe in the rule of law, right? And so we're a nation of laws. You probably hear that all the time on people yelling about it on Fox News and CNN, but it's the truth. We believe that the rule of law is there because we have our rights that come from God that the government protects, and then the government is also there, you know, to protect us in certain cases. The federal government, like, their one job that they're actually there for is for national defense and everything else. Whether you view it as an issue militarily or national security-wise, we are a nation of laws because we need to protect the people who live in this country. And so I don't know if your question was specifically about what the conservative answer on immigration is, or so that's, Jolie mentioned it last night, but Young America's Foundation has no party line. And so you would look at it, I think, probably from a fiscally conservative perspective, and also look at it sort of from the compassionate conservative perspective, right? And so the debate, I think, if you look within the conservative movement right now, is how do you balance those two things? You know, obviously we embrace the American dream, as we talked about, and want people to come here because we believe that this is the greatest place of opportunity in the world, but we also respect that there needs to be a rule of law. And so I think there's a balance somewhere in there that can be struck, where you have the process to come here for anyone. Obviously, you know, as conservatives, we believe limited government is good. So if you look at the way the legal immigration system is set up right now, it's a mess, right? It takes years, if not longer, in order to get through the process. You have to do all this paperwork and all these forms, and it's just not streamlined because the bureaucratic overgrowth is so bad. So maybe it's reforming something like that in order to make it simpler for people who want to come here legally. But, you know, obviously, we understand why people want to come here because of how great America is. Questions? Any more? No? Okay. Well, that is it. Thank you guys so much.